all of you. I am Sanjay Panse. I am convener of today's seminar. What we are going to do is we are going to begin with what Rambhav Maghe Prabodhini is, and I am going to introduce the trustees. And Ravindra Sathe, who is executive director of Rambhav Maghe Prabodhini, will introduce.
Namaskar and very good morning to all of you. I am Ravindra Sathe, working here as executive director of this institute. We have with us Mr. Arvind Rage, who is our board member. He formally will welcome all of you, and then documentary on Prabodhini. We will screen the documentary on Prabodhini so that you will get more information about this institute. So I will hand over to Mr. Rage.
Good morning to all of you. On behalf of my own self and the managing committee of Rambhav Maghe Prabodhini, I welcome all the dignitaries for this today's seminar. We normally conduct many seminars and workshops on various subjects. Our objective is that before taking or forming an opinion, both the sides on the subject should be deliberated, discussed, and tested also, or tried also. So in the same way, as far as this seminar is concerned, detailed discussions on both the sides of the subject, and if required, some trials also should be conducted before forming any opinion whether particular thing is right or not, to be followed or not. And I hope that this today's seminar will serve that purpose, that both the sides will be discussed. Some examples also will be given. Those who have conducted trials, they also will share their experiences. And this today's deliberations will be useful to form some conclusions by the end of the day. I once again welcome you and hope that all these deliberations will be going smoothly and as per our expectations and everybody's expectations with which you have come here. Thank you very much.
Before I plan to begin today's technical sessions, I wanted to explain the background and the origin of this seminar which we organized with Rambhav Maghe Prabodhini. As it happened, Vinay Sahasrabuddhi, who is the Director General, may be joining us, of Rambhav Maghe Prabodhini, had invited me on some event where we interacted with BJP leaders. And during that course of lunch, Minister for Fertilizer, Anant Kumar had joined. And during the course of discussions, I happened to ask him as to what is the view of GM at the top and at the cabinet and at levels. So he paused a minute and looked at us and told, what is the view of Rambhav Maghe Prabodhini? So I looked at Vinay as to what is the view of Rambhav Maghe Prabodhini. So he said that let's form it, and why don't you gather all the pros and all the people from various institutions and stakeholders, and again from various institutions. So we decided to, that was the origin of this seminar. The objective is to bring all the issues to the table, not to leave that any discussions which is fruitful, any issues which are material have to be on the table, have to be discussed, and the feedback and the documentation or the videos or the material which will emerge from this seminar would be given to the appropriate authorities. That's the whole objective of this seminar. The structure is today made by us is to various technical sessions. Medium would be Hindi or English, no Marathi please. So that object would be, first there would be a presenter and a session coordinator. A session coordinator would ensure that can speak himself and would ensure that everybody gets the opportunity to speak after the coordinator presents his case. My request is to the presenter to come here in this seat and make a presentation. Before we start, we will have 2 minutes. We will have a self-introduction for all the delegates. I am Sanjay Panse. I am director of Project for Economic Education, which is associated with Rambhavamaki Prabodhini for this event. By qualification, I am financial consultant and CA, associated with Rambhavamaki Prabodhini and Chatkari Sangatna.
I'm Dr. Sanjay Harke from Mahatma Gandhi Mission Biotechnology Department.
I am Professor M.C. Varshnit, Vice Chancellor, Kamdhenu University, Gandhinagar, Gujarat. Basically, Kamdhenu University is veterinary, animal husbandry, dairy, and fisheries university. It is the only veterinary university of Gujarat. I have been associated with the Anand Agricultural University also. For 2 terms, I was the Vice Chancellor of Anand Agricultural University. And therefore, I am associated with the crop as well as animal husbandry, both these sectors. So while I will be presenting my views, I will be referring both these sectors, that is the crop as well as animal sector.
I'm Dilnawaz Varyava. Background, I was in the first batch at IIM Ahmedabad, and I've been in industry for quite a few years until my retirement. But for the last 40 years, I've also made a point of putting part of my time into social issues, basically on issues of sustainability. Sustainable development, ecologically and economically sustainable development issues. I was Chief Executive of World Wildlife Fund India, Vice President of the Bombay Natural History Society for 20 years and on various government committees dealing with environment planning and coordination, wildlife, etc. But for the last 10 years, after I was invited by Dr. Swaminathan to look at the ecological foundation for sustainable agriculture, I have been working with rural issues, farmer issues, and how one can get sustainability in agriculture.
Dilip Karmelkar, Managing Editor of Viveko.
I'm Paresh Verma. I work for DCM Shriram Limited in their seed business. I'm a geneticist and plant breeder by training.
Good morning, my name is Kamesh Ram Foundation. I'm the Director General of Able Agriculture Group, which is the agriculture biotech industry group. I have been in the field of agriculture for 35 years after my
My name is Narayanan. I'm basically trained in agriculture. Both my undergraduate and master's degree is in agriculture. My specialization at PhD has been in plant breeding and genetics, and further postdoctoral training under a Rockefeller Fellowship at Stanford University in some of the new techniques in biology. I am one of the founders and now the managing director of a company in Bangalore called Metahelix Life Sciences. Since the last 4 years, we are now part of the Tata Group. We are a Tata enterprise. So we mainly work on developing improved seeds, all the tools, and using all the tools that biology has to offer today, from conventional breeding to molecular techniques. Whatever suits the particular objective, I think we employ. Thank you.
Ashok Chaubhure. I come from the business family based in Goa. In addition, I have a responsibility to Vishnu Zabarishan as a Karyadaksha, looking after the external units of Vishnu Zabarishan. I have had education in economics and statistics and business studies. And because of this, okay, I've kept myself abreast of issues related to economic development.
I am Dr. Mai. I am basically was a professor at Parbadi for almost 25 years. I also worked in Punjab Agriculture University, Ludhiana for 5 years. Then I became vice chancellor of that university. After that, I took up as director of Central Institute of Cotton Research for 3 years. Then went to Delhi as Commissioner Agriculture, Government of India. And then I was put to as a chairman of Scientist Recruitment Board of the country, which recruited all scientists in the ICR system. Almost nearly 5,000 scientist recruitment we have done. And I was the one who were associated with the release of first GM crop in this country, that is BT cotton. I was director then, and I was invited by GESC specifically to have, because entire trials, 55 trials of the country were conducted by me under our ICR system.
Good morning. My name is Bhagirath Chaudhary. I'm associated with an NGO called IS-AAA, which is based at Cornell University in the US, with a network, we call it Biotech Information Center. We try to follow the rapidly evolving technology across the world and put together information annually and share information on this technology with the global society. Thank you.
Sir, Dinesh Kumar from Nexus of Nutrition, Hyderabad. I am the coordinator for the preclinical evaluations of GMOs, LMOs, recombinants, and whichever are the innovative products. And this is the only public sector institute existing in India, established by Indian Council of Medical Research.
Namaste, I am Dr. Shyam Kushtekar from Nasik. I have worked for Shetkari Singhanal. Basically, I am from public health. I have been writing about health policy. I have worked with National Rural Health Mission some time, and I have been part director of School of Health Sciences.
I'm Govind Joshi, a farmer, I'm a graduate farmer, agricultural graduate farmer. I come from Parbani, a district in Marathwada, which is a Maharashtra state. Farming is my main state. I had been in the business of trading agro inputs for over a period of 35 years. I'm long associated with
Shetkari. I'm Rahi Kathoe. I have done my master's in public administration, and I have been studying behavioral and psychological aspects of resistance to GM crops in India.
I am Marvendra Kathoe. I teach at Baba Sahib Ambedkar Marathwada University. I teach biochemistry and biotechnology, and I'm associated with Shetkari Sangathana for the last 20 years.
European mode, I think that's the best thing to do.
Registered.
It doesn't receive any signal at
all.
So we don't play then.
I'm Rajiv Sane, writer and freelance journalist in Marathi. And my inclination is pro-liberalization and pro-development.
I'm Gautam Chaubhure. My education is in engineering. I come from a business family, and my interest in GM foods is more of a on a nutritional basis than a on etc.
Good morning, my name is Subhara. I'm from Mexico. I'm basically an agriculture
Namaskar. My name is Raju Barwale. I am Managing Director of Maharashtra Hybrid Seeds Company Limited. We are in the business of converting knowledge into wealth for our customers. I have an agriculture background and I have been involved in this business for last 30 years.
Good morning. My name is Shilpa Divekar Nirula. I am an MBA by profession and a chartered and cost accountant. I have the privilege of representing Monsanto in this forum today. I lead the Monsanto organization for India, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh and Nepal. I am the unlikely person from many of the industry colleagues here because I don't have an agriculture background. I've been working for 19 years and after the first 4.5 years, I actually chose to be part of the agriculture and food sector. From consulting to working with another company and then actually choosing to join Monsanto because of what they do. So I do hope we have the opportunity to share with all of you through the rest of the day the various activities that you know we are involved with the farmers of India. Thank you.
नमस्कार मेरा नाम धीरज पंत है और मेरी ट्रेनिंग प्लांट ब्रीडिंग और जेनेटिक्स के क्षेत्र में हुई है एंड मैं मोनसेंटो के साथ अभी रेगुलेटरी अफेयर्स विभाग में कार्यरत हूँ पिछले 25 वर्ष का मुझे सीड इंडस्ट्री में अनुभव है
मेरा नाम मोहिनी मोहन मिश्रा है मैं भारतीय किसान संघ है देश का सबसे बड़ा फार्मर्स ऑर्गेनाइजेशन है उसका नेशनल सेक्रेटरी हूँ बैकग्राउंड मेरा मैं MSc SG भी हूँ मूलतः उड़ीसा का हूँ आजकल मैं दिल्ली में रहता हूँ और अपने संगठन करीब देश में 400 डिस्ट्रिक्ट से अधिक डिस्ट्रिक्ट में अपना ऑर्गेनाइजेशन एक्टिव है इस सिलसिले में हम काफ़ी दिनों से 2008 से ये GM फूड के विषय में अनुष्ठान मैंने समझने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं
Dr. Subhash Ashle, I am a general surgeon practicing in Kolhapur, Maharashtra. I am interested in various social issues and especially regarding the disinformation that is going on in various journals and newspapers. I would like to remove that disinformation.
I am Ajit Narde from Kolhapur. I am a farmer and also associated with Chetkari Sangatna. And I am also a journalist and a publisher also. I publish a directory of Indian Sugar Industries. That's
मैं दिनेश कुलकर्णी भारतीय किसान संघ संगठन का अखिल भारतीय संगठन मंत्री हूँ मेरा केंद्र पुणे है BSc और MSc की पढ़ाई परभनी से पूरी करने के बाद में मैं सोशल वर्किंग में हूं और अभी अखिल भारतीय संगठन मंत्री के रूप में भारतीय किसान संघ को देख रहा हूं।
गुड मॉर्निंग एंड वेलकम एवरीबॉडी माय नेम इज गणेश आई रिप्रेजेंट हियर द क्रॉप प्रोटेक्शन इंडस्ट्री आल्सो नोन एज एग्रो केमिकल इंडस्ट्री और पेस्टिसाइड्स इंडस्ट्री एंड बाय वे ऑफ क्वालिफिकेशंस I am qualified primarily from the field of agricultural science and next in the field of environmental law. So that gives adequate perspective into issues, some of them are very contentious that we will be discussing here. Okay, thank you.
Vinod Pawar, Chowkuli Group, Mumbai. I don't know anything about this. It's better to listen and understand what's going on.
I'm Mahesh Ponerkar. I'm from Weekly Magazine, Vivek.
Yeah, I'm Priyadarshini. My background is in social work and for several years in rural development. Now I'm with Mindco in a license group.
Yeah. Thank you, all of you. Before we begin, we have some introductory remarks from Ashok Rao, where we will set the ball rolling.
Sanjay gave a background about what happened, how this meeting came up to be in an interaction with the Minister of Fertilizer. After that, I think that we accidentally met at a function in the Dr. Kevar Hospital in Aurangabad. And we started talking about this, and then he said, okay, why not? And then we just exchanged a few notes, and I thought, and that's how this program has come to be. As I said, like I have no, but we have, as an industry, we have no interest, nor do we plan to have any interest as far as agriculture is concerned. But my personal interest being being economic development, you know, I thought like, you know, I have been like studying these particular issues related to not just to you know, to GM, but various other particular issues also. I must start to say at the beginning that I am in you know, completely in favor of GM crops, because I think it is a way forward for our country and for the you know, for the people. And I hope I'll be somewhere along the line contribute a few of my you know, whatever I have I've learned, whatever I've studied, I've seen. And I think it is unfortunately being made into, I would call it, a contentious issue. I think, but because part of the reason I see that in discussing, there's too many issues, okay, too many aspects are simultaneously, I think, put on the table instead of looking at some of the issues, okay, one by one, particularly related to science. And I hope I'm able to learn on this aspect from the deliberations that will happen today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashokra. As we have decided about the to bring all the issues on the table, it's not that we want to take any particular view and which that view needs to be carried across, but we want to put all the issues in the table, discuss about them, and discuss the merits or risks or the management of it, and place them before the authorities. So with this, I'll begin the first session. Want to start with the basics relating to GM crops. First session is by C.D. Mai, Dr. C.D. Mai.
It's a very important sort of discussion on genetically modified crops, whether they are helpful or harmful, because this question is for the long time being discussed but not resolved. I was a professor for 25 years in one university called as Parbadi. There, my mother asked me once, what is that you teach as a pathologist? And what is that pathology? I said, I told my mother, you cannot understand it. Then she replied, if you cannot explain me what is pathology, then it is better not to do any science. The problem with biotechnology is that communication is the biggest problem in biotechnology. How simplest you put it in a language, it's still most difficult to be understood. That's why I said that if you cannot explain to your mother what is that you do in the name of science, it is worth not doing it. Same problem exists here. If we are not able to explain what exactly we do in the name of biotechnology, I think it is better to stop it. But here there are some issues which is very important, and I thought that I must able to brief you about it. Now this is a very common, just a very simplest possible definition of what is called as GM. Sometimes it is called as genetic engineering. Genetic engineering is a mechanism for producing genetically modified crops. It is also referred as, if which involves incorporation of a new gene. Again a word comes gene, because now these are some of the basic things which I think everybody would know it. Responsible for specific trait, whatever we have, into a genome of a desired plant. As a result of this, transgenic variety acquires a new trait that is inheritable. And this is a unique feature of GE, that its desired gene can be identified, it can be isolated, and it can be introduced from any living source which may be totally unrelated. Now I go to little simple. Now sometimes people ask, what is genetics? I said, genetics is the science of inheritance and variability. Very simple definition. Again, if I tell a farmer that this is genetics, he doesn't understand it. I explain to him that genetics is a son is like father, but he is not father. So this is what is genetics. You inherited it. A jawar plant, when you grow, will always produce a jawar plant. It will not produce a maize. Why? This is genetics. And I said that the same son, you may he look like, but he cannot be like, cannot be a replica of total father, because he inherits several genes. This is what is variability. So on the earth, no two individuals on this earth are similar. And that is the basic crux of genetic. And now once we check, this science has come forward in terms of utilizing this variability in our seeds. And that's why we preserve these seeds. So you have 40,000 rice varieties preserved. We have 10,000 cotton varieties preserved. There is a big range of them. And we have now institutions world over and in India to preserve them. Now the simplest, when mankind started looking into cultivation after its existence as the Stone Age, the first thing he tried to do is that when he saw there are plants, he saw the best plants one to keep as a seed for himself. That is called as ancient method of general selection. But then, over a period of time, when there is an improvement, then we started what is called as a mass selection technique, what is called as a pure line selection technique, where it is the improved method of selection by which you can really have, this is one method of crop improvement. Then came hybridization, because then came the Mendel's law around the 20th century beginning, and then we had backcrossing program, heterosis, which is called as a hybrid breeding program, and what is called as basically population genetics. All these are what is called as a traditional breeding method. Now there is an improvement over these methods. All what you have learned in your first green revolution, the green revolution which has already occurred in Jawar and Bajra, dry land crop, is all because of that traditional breeding. Now we are looking into how improvement in breeding can occur. There is one technique called as molecular breeding, another is called as a transgenic or cisgenic. Now cisgenic is another is the method, we will explain it later. Biotechnology therefore is basically an extension of plant breeding. We simply call it as an extension. Now here the mechanism is very simple, that when you make in traditional breeding the crosses, it is what called as a blind crosses. I take a variety which is resistant to a disease or a tall variety, and I want to bring dwarfness, I cross them. I do not see by eye what is happening. I take a pollen of this, put it on the female of the other plant, and then take the progeny and go on selecting till I get the desired result. That is what we call it. Now exactly this has been modified in case of genetic. Here, what we do is now we have received techniques by which we identify specific genes for a particular trait. Suppose I know that there is a trait for drought tolerance, can I isolate it, identify it, and put it where there is a space on the genome so that it can really function. And then check it. There are of course techs. This is the simplest form. There are so many complex things. But that is what we say in plant biotechnology. The desired gene is put here as the red dot, and then the desired gene which we commercially cross it so that we know now only that gene. So you do not have any linkage of other drags along with that gene which is happening in the blind crossing. And this how the technique has really been worked out. Now in case of BT protein, let us say Bacillus thuringiensis is the common soil bacteria which every microbiologist knows in this country. And this bacteria was known because it has a biological control ability to control the pest, that is bollworm. When the bollworm eats this spores of this bacteria, then they immediately gets that toxin and they are killed. Now people thought that why every time, because then there are several issues and there are several commercial preparations available. It is also used in organic farming as a common form. Today if somebody organic farming which is allowed, BT is allowed as a spray in organic farming. Very interestingly. Now here is, these are the BT crystal spores, and then you can see this is the spore which has, we have different type of crystal, and of course there are a lot of studies which has been made more technically to see what are those various kinds of regimes which are useful. Now we'll come to simple mechanism. These crystals and spores are eaten by the, basically these are eaten by the insect, and the pH is almost 12. Then the crystal dissolves and the protein processes to smaller active forms of the gut enzyme. There is a gut enzyme, and then the activated toxin binds to receptor in the midgut epithelium, and then this is killed. This is a very simple reason. Why therefore it is very specific to Lepidopteran pest? Why it is only specific? Why it cannot act on other butterfly? Why BT is not active? So this cryoprotein actually get disintegrated only at pH 12, which doesn't exist in human beings or animals or any other insect. And that's why it is highly specific, and that's why it is used. So BT protein kills specific groups of caterpillars. Non-target organisms lack receptors in their gut for binding BT protein, and BT protein does not affect non-target organisms at all, even birds or mammals, as they lack the receptor or have the acidic pH where BT protein do not work. This is basically the principle for specificity. Now if you look into green revolution, identification of dogs, green revolution also has occurred because of genetics. Basic issue is genetics, because it is the movement of gene, RH1 and RH2 genes, which was the Norim genes, which were transferred to wheat to make them dwarf. Now this is comes from what is called as a primary gene pool of wheat and rice, RHT gene in wheat and SD1 gene in rice, backcrossing of dwarfing cultivar with locally adapted wheat variety and affected it. Thus, this is why we call these as the selection and Mendelian genetic primary genetic pool. Self-pollinated crops mein ye bahut common hai, where we can use such kinds of pools in wheat and rice. That's why the revolution has come there. And you can see in these revolutions, what is the difference in production. In during that period, there is a tremendous rise from 50 million tons at the time of independence. Today we are 260 million tons of food production. Imagine, there was a shortage, there was queue for ration shop to buy Milo in 1965-66. That trade has totally vanished, and today we have a problem shortage of godowns where we are not able to keep our wheat. Now this is what the technology means. The second, dry land agriculture, particularly in Maharashtra where I come from, the most significant revolution has come because of heterogeneous breeding, called as hybrid breeding. Now this hybrid breeding has come from secondary pool. Basically we call this is a different, because you take the parents of different parents and use those pollens and then bring out the hybrid. So this hybrid vigor has used in sorghum, in bajra. Initially when these hybrids were brought, there were a lot of problems. Downy mildew came, some the sorghum hybrids were all worst in terms of quality. Even the Maharashtra government questioned the wisdom of bringing. There was tremendous criticism on scientists, like what you are hearing on GM, that why do we bring such technology which is useless. Over a period of time, we have improved upon those, because ultimately in science you take time to go on improving. Today I think it is an established fact, and then you can see that genetic pool. Today the vegetables, all round year round vegetables are available mainly because of hybrids. You have hybrids of chilies, you have hybrids of tomato, you have hybrids of bhindi, hybrids of bitter gourd, bottle gourd, what not. Now they are all marketed, and that's why you have different qualities of material available. Same thing which has happened in sorghum, which has happened in bajra, which has happened in cotton, which has happened in castor. These revolutions have really helped them. That's why we call them that the secondary gene pool has evolved. Now the third genetic manipulation or modification is what we call it as the GM crops. Now this is a GM pool which is not related. Now in case of traditional breeding, you have to have nearby species to cross. In case of heterogeneous breeding, you can use the wild species of the same crop. But here you need not use any of them. If you find ekhadya boricha jhada madhe in any bori ber ke ped mein, if you aapko acha gene lagega, we can isolate that gene and put it here, because that is resistant to drought. Now this is what the technology means. And this specific putting of the gene is what we call it as. Now extensive utilization of these particularly cry genes for imparting insect resistance has been done in case of BT cotton, in case of maize, cotton, canola and soybean. And that's why you can see what the important modification has come. This slide is very common in almost every country where BT cotton was introduced. There has been a significant increase in the productivity and production of the crop. You can see after 2003, what a big jump which has already occurred. Now this is again the same, which you can see 1960 onward, 2010, what is the range of productivity available there. Now if you say, I would just, this is in brief about what the basics about it, and I would like Narayanan to really continue.
So I will give a different a view from a different angle. Again,
we have a new participant. If you can introduce, we have all introduced ourselves.
Okay.
So briefly introduce yourself, and we'll start. Sorry, we're just late, and good morning, friends. I'm K.C. Bansal. I'm director of the National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources from the Indian Council of Agriculture Research System, and I'm a practicing biotechnologist for many, many years associated with the scenario of GM crops in the country, and we know how important it is to take it forward. And thank you for inviting us here. Thank you very much.
Good morning, Dr.
Bansal.
Thank you. Dr. Anjali Warrior is also here.
Yeah, good morning. We got information about this meeting only late last evening. So we took the morning flight, so we are just arrived, so we are a bit late. Apologies for that, and thank you for inviting us. I am Dr. Ranjini Warrior. I'm director in the Ministry of Environment and Forest. I'm also the member secretary of the Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. I'll be glad to participate and listen from all of you. Thank you.
Good night. Anybody else? Okay. So to both of you, we are just looking at the basic science of GM crops and genetic modification. So Dr. Mai just finished his presentation. You probably saw that. So just continuing on the same theme, I'm just going to give you a different take. Because if you look at the elephant from different angles, you try to understand what an elephant is. So genetic modification of crops is not new. So ever since the advent of agriculture, see, people say it could be traced back to about 10,000 years ago. Now, when settled agriculture came into being, before that we were all hunter-gatherers, and I think the human history, a landmark change in the human history happened with settled agriculture. We are probably able to sit around this table and discuss whether we should have GM crops or non-GM crops because we have settled agriculture, because a certain group of people are able to produce food for all of us. Otherwise, we will be worrying about hunting the next animal or trying to gather the next food for ourselves. So, settled agriculture began with the modification of two aspects of the plant. One is the nature, the other is its nurture. When I talk about nature, you know, the trees around us, the rivers, that is one view of nature, that's one aspect of nature. But the other aspect, when we say nature, it is nature of the being itself. For example, like we say that, you know, this guy, you know, he eats a lot, but he doesn't put on weight. Ye unka prakriti hai. That is his nature. For example, he is 5 feet 10 inches tall. That is his nature. By nature, he is short. By nature, he is soft-spoken. So, that is the nature. So, the nature of a being, for example, if you take a rice plant, the height of a rice plant, its ability to produce, uske utpadak kshamata, or its ability to resist a disease or pest, that is the nature of the plant. The nature of the plant is determined by its genetic makeup. You know, Professor Mai talked about the genetics. I will explain to you what that is. The second aspect which has been continuously modified is the nurture or the external environment that we provide for the plants to grow. It includes agronomy, it includes irrigation, it includes fertilizer, but I'm not going to talk about that much, but I'm going to talk about nature. Now, I told you the basis for the nature, for a being what it is the genetic makeup. Now, from time immemorial, people have been wondering about what is it that determines the nature of an organism. If you take Aristotle, you know, written history, they have talked about there could be some germules, some theory, that is, each part of the body. How is it, Professor Mai talked about, you know, inheritance of traits. There are many traits. For example, I will look in many ways like my father or my mother, but I am not identical to my father. So that is, whatever makes me similar is the inheritance, or that is called heredity. And whatever makes me different is called the variation. So the study of heredity and variation is the science of genetics. So what is the cause for the heredity and variation? So I told you about Aristotle. They have talked about germules, that each part of the body makes small replicas of itself which circulates in the body blood. They come together and merge in the offspring, and that creates a new trait. In fact, that was fairly popular. Even in our Vedas, if you look at it, the little that I know about it, if you look at Purusha Sukta, one of the hymns of the Rig Veda, there are references to the body parts of the Purusha or the cosmic being being assembled into different lineages. So this concept was there till about 200 years ago. So genetic modification of crops was essentially in one way trying to change the nature of the plant and on the other side trying to change the nurture of the plant. So for the last 10,000 years ago settled agriculture started, for almost 9,800 years the genetic modification of crop plants was happening through deliberate human action, but in some ways without understanding the basis of how the changes were happening, like we say intuitively or experiential learning. For example, when our ancient farmer forefathers, they were selecting the best part of the crop and keeping it for seed as for the next generation and eating the rest, what was essentially happening is they were accumulating the desirable genes into a certain genotype or a certain variety which they can cultivate further. Now, if you take all the crop plants that we are seeing today, they are all in that sense genetically modified. In fact, today with the new tools that we have, we can analyze what has been the genetic modification that has gone on. I am just giving you one example. So we all know what this is, right? Maize, bhutta, what we get. You know, just 7,000 years ago, we didn't have, this is after the advent of settled agriculture. This maize was not existent. It is essentially a process, a result of what the modifications that has happened to this plant. This is called Zia maize parviglumis. It's the same species. It's called Theosinte. So it is still today found. The evolved forms of this Theosinte is found. So through selection by the Incan and the Mayan civilizations in Southern America, they accumulated the useful genes which will make it useful for cultivation. So today you can use the latest techniques. This is a paper which was published in 2009 which tries to find out what is the genetic difference. You know, literally many genes have been changed and literally thousands of genes have been modified in their expression levels to move from this to this. So in plant breeding, Professor Mai described about how we do genetic modification. I told you in the last 9,800 years, this was happening through intuition, experiential learning. It was in the mid-19th century, 1865 to be exact, this man, a priest in an Austrian monk, so he proposed. He did experiments with pea because after their religious activities, they had free time, they could experiment with pea plants. And he, from the Gemmule theory where you talk about merging of characters, he proposed a revolutionary new idea. He proposed in 1865, but the importance of it was recognized only in 1901 because he was much ahead of his time. His major contention was these genetic traits are controlled by discrete factors. It was not that each part was making miniature portions of them called gemmules. It was controlled by factors which are present in every cell. Sabhi kosh mein, ek ek kosh mein, we have got those factors. And they exist in pairs. Because now we know that every organism has got two sets of every chromosome. Because later the factors came to be known as genes. And the genes we know are present in chromosomes. So when chromosomes are present in pairs, the genes are present in pairs. And you can have alternative forms of these pairs. So that is the revolutionary, and these remain discrete. So when there are two parents which cross, the genetic determinants of the trait, they remain discrete, they don't merge with each other. So that in the later generations, you can further segregate them. New combinations of these alleles or genes can happen for giving rise to new traits. So this was a revolution. This now explains the genetics, the variation. You can use mathematical techniques to predict. So since the rediscovery of the Mendel's laws in 1901, plant breeding became more of a science and a deliberate effort, not purely based on intuition, not purely based on experiential learning. So, just to explain to you in the next five or six minutes, how do we do plant breeding? Now, I am giving you an example of a flower. I don't know how many of you can recognize this. I come from Bangalore, it's a flower city. This is carnation, right? So, one is a white flower, it has got a short stalk. Another is a red flower, it has got a long stalk. Now, let us say for putting it in a vase, the short stalk is better because the long stalk may fall over. Now, in terms of attractiveness, the red flower is better than the white flower. So now I have only these two types. Now if I know that the stalk length and the color of the flower is determined by discrete factors or genes as we call them now, you also know much more about the genes. We know the stuff that makes the genes is actually a chemical called DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid. It is a polymer, that means it's like a chain, and then portions of it, which you can conceive of it as beads in the chain, they are the genes, or they determine each different character. Now, if I know that, I can choose the parents, let us say these two, I will cross them. When I cross them, what happens? One set of genes will come from this parent, another set of genes will come from this parent. So, in the first generation of crossing, it will express a trait where both the genes are present together, both the type of genes are present together. But what happens in the next generation? That is when these genes will segregate. Because they are not merging with each other, they are still present independently. They have the ability to segregate independently and they will form different combinations. Okay? Now I want to introduce two concepts here. One is, there is this question of what is a hybrid? We all talk about hybrid variety. Then Professor Mayu talked about the high-yielding varieties where the genes, the dwarfing genes have been introduced. These are varieties derived through hybridization. So, by this segregation, you are essentially creating a variation. Now, you see, there will be tall ones, some which are having a different set of traits, but you will get one, if you have a sufficient population, which has a short stalk and a red flower. This is what we wanted in our objective of what we want to breed. And this is selected out. Now in this process, and then through repeated selfing or repeated breeding, you can fix this trait. Now this results in a variety derived through hybridization. In many instances, Professor Mayu talked about hybrid vigor and hybrid varieties. In that case, I showed you the earlier parents. If they are stabilized parents, you can cross them. And if you cross chosen parents, you get a phenomena what is called hybrid vigor. This is the hybrid that is in the first generation. You don't go through several generations like this. In the first generation, it will express much higher vigor. And that is the hybrid vigor. So if a farmer buys a hybrid rice or a hybrid maize crop, he essentially gets the benefit because of the hybrid vigor. But if the farmer further cultivates, the seed will germinate. There will be no issues about seed germination. Why does he go back to the organization which produced the hybrid seed? Because the next generation, if he cultivates, because it is formed through a mixture of two parents, it will start segregating like I have shown here. So a farmer, if he himself cultivates, it will start segregating. And a farmer, you know, there are many farmer friends here. You know that, you know, you don't want your field with one flowering early, one flowering late, one having different traits. You want a uniformity. That is why for hybrid seeds, people go back to the organization which has the parental seed which produces the hybrids. Now look at this example. We talked about two carnations. One carnation having red flower, another carnation having white flower, one having long stalk, one having short. That means the trait that we want to improve is available within the carnation germplasm itself. Okay, so you could cross two carnations. Now let us assume that the long stalk and short stalk is there, but you don't have a red carnation at all in the carnation group that you have collected. So can you now look at a red rose and see whether I can cross it with the carnation to make a red carnation? That is not possible. Because carnation and rose are cross-impatible. They are different species. So that is what the new technique now allows. With the study of biology, we now know that the genetic elements are the same. Whether the determinants of a trait in rose or a determinant of a trait in carnation, or for that matter, determinants of traits in humans or in rice, they are all this DNA fragment. There is a commonality, universal commonality in the whole thing. So, if you have techniques by which you can introduce the gene, like Professor Mai said, if you can have a burr plant from which you say, let us take a drought tolerant trait, you can introduce the cotton, you cannot do it by the earlier methods of genetic modification. So that is where the new technique comes about, and that is called plant genetic transformation, and which has become, because here the new techniques allow you to transfer foreign genes. I am putting it in inverted commas. A gene from a rose to a carnation, or from a bird to a cotton, or from a bacillus thuringiensis, BT bacteria to a cotton. So this is where, this is where it has become controversial for many reasons. One of the reasons at least is that they think, you know, you are playing God. You are now, I understand, but which is actually not the case. Because science is not playing God. Science is observing what God has made, trying, even sending a rocket. It is not that, you know, Newton invented gravity. Gravity has always been there. You know, whether Newton was there, but when an apple fell on his head, he thought about what is this phenomena? He observed it. He did many calculations. He realized that masses will attract each other. And he did some experiments to figure out what is the force of that attraction. He came out with the theory that the size of the masses is directly proportional to the force of attraction. The distance between them is inversely proportional to the square root. So all those, and based on that, we now can calculate what should be the velocity with which you should project an object from the Earth so that it goes outside the bounds of the gravitational field of the Earth. So, escape velocity. So now if I have to put something to the Mars, like we have done, Emma, you have to accelerate it to a velocity of 11.3, which is the escape velocity, and it goes there. So that's how we... So similarly, it is not that we are playing God. We have observed in nature, I want you to focus on these panels. There is a bacteria, or there is a disease of some of these crops called crown gall tumor. You see the tumorous growth here? Can you see it clearly? Crown is the portion above the ground. And in rose, actually, this you can sometimes get it in the temperate regions, cooler regions of this country as well. This is called crown gall tumor. Now this crown gall tumor disease is actually caused by a bacteria. It is called Agrobacterium tumefaciens. So what does this bacterium do to cause this tumor? It doesn't kill this plant. It causes this grotesque growth. The plant is little debilitated because some of the energy goes into that. The bacteria, actually, it has been found, it transfers a portion of its gene to the plant. And that gene, or the genes in that portion of its DNA, contains certain genes for producing certain hormones, which produces this tumor. It also produces certain chemicals called opines. These opines are food for the bacteria. So what is the bacteria doing? It is genetically modifying the plant, and it is creating its own food and providing a house for it to stay. That is what is happening in nature. So when in the last 50 years of research, people have discovered the mechanism by which this natural phenomenon happens. Now, like I talked about gravity, now can I employ it for something useful to transfer useful genes? Let us say I have a gene which is useful from bacteria, but I don't know how to transfer it into, say, cotton. So you can use a similar method. This is one of the most popular methods for plant genetic transformation. So in nature, the Agrobacterium is present in the roots. It has got a portion of the DNA called tDNA, or transfer DNA, in a plasmid called tumor-inducing plasmid, which it transfers to the plant cell, and the plant produces a tumor. This is a cartoon. So in our lab, what do? You take the bacteria, you remove the portions of the DNA which produces the tumor, and insert the gene of your interest. So what you do, you are essentially tricking a natural bacterium, which we call disarmed because you have now removed the hormone producing thing, to transfer the gene of your interest into the plant of your interest and produce a new trait. So we study nature, we understand what is happening. Nobody has invented agrobacterium, has been there much before humans have been there. The crown gall tumor disease has been there much before humans have experienced it or looked at it and studied it. So this is how it's a cartoon. Now this is an actual picture of how it is done in cotton. This is happening in our lab. So you can see the callus and you can see the plants coming out. And these ones will have the gene of your interest. Now, I will just quickly stop with just one more slide on BT cotton. Those are, I think Mai did explain some things about this. Now, what is this? This is our own experiment. I'm not talking about, see, in India, there are many, many labs, including ours. I told you this, ours is a company which was founded by me and a few of others. We started very small. We had success, some funding from Infosys founders initially. But today we are part of the Tata Group. There are many public research institutes which also do this kind of research. Actually, this is actually a picture of our own field trial of our BT cotton. So what is BT cotton? You know, the Bacillus thuringiensis is a bacterium which was first described about 150 years ago. I think in 1901, German. First it was discovered by Iwata in Japan. They discovered it in the silkworm moths. You know, silkworm belongs to the butterfly family. Silkworms are dying. So this is a pathogen of the silkworm. But it was described much better by Berliner in Germany. And that is why the name Bacillus, which only means rod-shaped, like spherococcus means spherical. So Bacillus means rod-shaped, you know, in Latin. Thuringiensis is after Thuringia, the region of Thuringia, from where Berliner came. So if I had been alive and I discovered it, say, 150 years ago or 100 years ago, I would have called it Bangaloreensis or Mumbaiensis or whatever it is.
Narayanensis.
Narayan.
No, no. So I'm just going to finish. So even today, if I take, see, I walk through this field. There must be maybe milligram amounts of soil in my below my feet. I take that soil, and if I spread it on a plate, I will find many microorganisms growing. Out of that, several of them will be bacteria. And many of those bacteria will be rod-shaped. So they will be bacilli. And at least some of them will have, may have, some activity against an insect. So I may still have to call it Bacillus thuringiensis. Maybe I will call it a substrain of RMP or something like that. So you find, in fact, in India, there is a public project which is anchored by University of Agriculture Sciences, Dharwad, where there is thousands of collections of these potential Bacillus thuringiensis strains for various uses. So that gene from that bacteria, and Professor Mai told you about the action, because what is pathogenic to an insect, even though we call it toxin, it's not toxic to you. For example, we have many toxin-producing bacteria, right? Vibrio cholerae, let us take for this. How is it toxic to you? Once you ingest it, the Vibrio cholerae produces a toxin, a protein called cholera toxin. The cholera toxin has a receptor in my gut. But let us say an insect consumes that Vibrio cholerae toxin, nothing will happen to the insect. The cholera toxin will be digested and become part of the protein nutrition for the insect. Similarly, if you drink, let us say you eat the BT protein, it becomes part of the nutrition for you as a protein. But it's a toxin for the specific insect. So, using the techniques I told you earlier, you cannot now persuade a bacteria to make love to a cotton plant. So, you have to use the other techniques which I mentioned earlier, agrobacterium-mediated transformation, or there are a few other techniques also. But this is the most popular one. You introduce the gene and then make the plant inherently resistant to the insect. Earlier, even today in organic farming, you spray the BT spray, and then but then when you spray, it may get washed out, it will get denatured by solar radiation. Now here, the plant will produce minute amounts of that. See, so that is the BT cotton technology. Now here, what we need to be aware of is, see, when you talk about safety or the genetic modification has been there universally, What is important is the safety or the efficacy of the ultimate product, not of the method by which you used it. Suppose, you know, we all know, we all make fire, right? So fire is, you know, quite, can be dangerous, but can be very useful. Now, if you say that the fire made by rubbing two flint stones, as our ancestors used to do, is it going to be more dangerous than the fire that you produce using, you know, striking a matchstick? So the methodology that you use is not what is important, but the ultimate product is what is going to be analyzed. So I will try to stop here, because I am sure that many of my colleagues will talk about the safety and other aspects, the analysis of that. So I was told that we should complete this discussion by 11:15. Panseji, is that correct? Okay. So we have
to invite.
No, we will invite. We will invite. But we have in about half an hour. We should also have a lot of discussion so that we get to it.
Yeah.
It's a big
thing. A question.
Yeah. To whom?
Narayan.
You want to take it now, or shall you hold the question so that we can have a comprehensive discussion at the end?
Yes. The presentation is not over.
No, this is just okay. Go ahead.
The tumor causing portion is removed and desired gene is put there.
Yes.
And the carrier is the plasmid.
Yes.
Now the plasmid has a capacity to cut genes and a capacity to join genes. Does this capacity remain after the transfer? I mean, is that plasmoid an active plasmoid after the transfer occurs?
Very valid question. I think this is also because I couldn't get into the details of the transfer mechanism. Let me make a point here. See, the tumor-inducing plasmid or the TI plasmid is the one which contains what is called the T-DNA or the transfer DNA which is transferred to the plant. So number one, even in the bacterial system, the native system, even before you disarm it or something, it is not the entire plasmid that is transferred, but only this portion which is transferred. And for the transfer, we have found out that what is required are specific a few base pairs. This is 25 base pairs. You know the nucleotides, these are the units of the DNA.
Yeah.
So 25 base pair on the left border and the right border, they are what determines the transfer. So you can put literally anything here. When I say literally, in biology nothing is black and white. There are conditions which have to be satisfied. You can put anything here and it will only, as long as the plasmid contains these borders, it will only be the DNA in between that gets transferred. So when I talk about tumor crossing bacteria, the genes and all, they are present in this region. Even in the native stage, when the tumor inducing T-DNA is transferred to the plant, the ability of that DNA to act as a plasmid is completely not there, because this is where the determinants of the plasmid replication and all those things are residing.
So there is no question of further destruction of genes or further attack on any genes?
No, there is no question of further attacking or further degeneration or attacking any other.
Thank you.